My students often tell me that they understand the concepts in physics but find it difficult to apply them to solve problems. And their obvious follow-up question is, what should they do? Well, for some students, physics comes easy. But the good news is that it can come as easy for others as well if they are ready to approach the subject a little more systematically. So I sat with one of my students who now studies engineering at UC Berkeley and wrote these 11 immutable laws of getting better at physics. And if you really follow them, there's a good chance that you might actually fall in love with the subject. So first of all, make consistent effort. Start by learning the theory well before you attempt numericals. This may require you to not only read your textbooks well, but also watch videos of the topics you are studying on a couple of channels. You may also like to see physics simulations on FATE from University of Colorado, which I think is really good. Well, if you wish to step up the game, you can watch lectures by Walter Lewin from MIT for some amazing physics demos and Shankar Ramamurthy from Yale for some great classes. So the second one is visualize physics. So what I mean is visualize the concepts as it might happen in real life, and you'll see that this can really speed up understanding of the topic. So let me give you an example. If you are reading, let us say, static and dynamic friction, imagine what is happening to a block placed on an inclined plane as the incline is increasing. You'd imagine from your experience that the block tends to stick to the inclined plane initially, but then starts moving as the incline increases. So relate these visualizations to what the concept of physics is saying, and you'll often end up making useful connections and therefore internalizing the concept a lot better. So that brings us to number three, and that is absorb contents of a tutorial in small chunks. So do not try to read everything in one go and expect that you'll understand everything. You'll really need to pause, visualize, ponder over what you read, and sometimes scribble your thoughts, equations, or diagrams on a piece of paper, and you'll see how much faster you will understand by going slow. So number four is understand the derivation of important equations. Well, it is easy to memorize equations, and it'll help you to solve some basic equations like, if let us say mass is equal to 2 kilograms, and say acceleration is 3 meters per second square. And the question is, what is the force? It is quite simple. We know that F is equal to mass into acceleration. And what you do is you find force by multiplying mass, which is given as 2 kilograms, into acceleration, which is given as 3 meters per second square. And you say that the force is equal to 6 newtons. But if you really want to tackle tough questions, see how the equations are derived. This makes things a lot clearer, and you'll find that you're able to not only solve harder questions, but also relate to the problems and its solution in a better way. So let us say if you were told that the momentum of a mass changed from 20 kilogram meters per second. So let's denote it by Li, and it is 20 kilogram meters per second. And it's given that the final momentum was equal to 26 kilogram meters per second. And let us say this happened in time t equal to 2 seconds. And the question is, what is the force on the object? Well, you may scratch your head and wonder if F is equal to ma can answer this question. But if you've seen the simple breakdown of the equation F is equal to ma as follows. So F is equal to ma is the basic equation. And the breakdown is that F is equal to m into acceleration, which is nothing but the rate of change of velocity. So we say V final minus V initial upon the time. And if we take mass inside, what we get is mv final minus mv initial upon time. And we know that the product of mass and velocity is nothing but momentum. So we can say that this is equal to L final, or the final momentum, minus the initial momentum upon time. And therefore, this is the rate of change of momentum, which is nothing but force. So force is not only mass into acceleration, but also equal to the rate of change of momentum. And we can write this as delta L upon delta T, where delta T is the time taken. And then you can solve this question. You know that will be 26 minus 20 divided by 2, or it'll come to about 3 meters per second square. So you see, often the derivation itself gives great clarity around the topic and the numerical problems that you attempt. So that brings us to tip number 5, and that is make neat diagram and deconstruct the problem. Making neat diagrams and putting all the available information around it can accelerate you towards writing the correct equations and therefore discovering the answers. A diagram simply converts the question into a picture that is so much easier to absorb and organize by the brain. And you don't really need to be a Michelangelo, just make well-labeled diagrams. Well, some questions come with a drawing, make sure you make good use of them. So let's go ahead and try to make a diagram around a problem, and I'll read the problem as I make the diagram. So the question says that there is a mass on an inclined plane, and the value of that mass is m. So here's my inclined plane. And let's go ahead and put a mass m here. And it's given that its value is m. And it's also given that the angle of this inclined plane is theta degrees. Then further, the problem says that there is another mass, capital M, at the other side. That is, actually there's a pulley. So we'll go ahead and make a pulley too. And the other side, there's another mass, capital M, which is strung up with this mass. So let's go ahead and make a string over here. And say the value of this mass is capital M. And it's also given in the problem that the height above which this mass is over the ground level is small h. So we'll go ahead and label small h over here. The question is, at what time after the two masses are released would the bigger mass be on a level which is h dash above the ground? So let's go ahead and label h dash as well. So let's say this is h dash. And we have to find the time after the system is released that this mass is at level h dash. So this is a diagram we have, and then we can go ahead and mark all the forces, and the first obvious force would be mg acting in downward direction for both the masses. So this is mg for the smaller mass, and this is the mg for the larger mass. Well, you can also go ahead and mark the other forces, which would be, let us say, the components of mg in this direction and in the direction along the inclined plane. So you see, you have your neat diagram over here. You could also say, well, if this is theta, then simple geometry will tell you that this is also theta. And then you can go ahead and mark this force as mg sine theta, and this one as mg cos theta. So now you have pretty much all the information around this question. This will kind of equip you to start solving this question by writing the equations probably on the right hand side. So that brings us to number 6, which is be disciplined about not rushing through when solving a numerical problem. You see, it is a physics problem, not a fiction novel. So do not jump steps while doing a problem. Write each step as you move ahead in finding solution of a problem. In other words, the time you gain by skipping steps may just not be worth it, because you can really confuse yourself as you move ahead in solving the problem and eventually end up getting the wrong answer and therefore redoing the problem. Well, once you're confident about the topic and have attempted a good number of questions, you may start skipping a few steps here and there, and you'll be just fine. So number 7 is get the basic understanding of math. Well, math is the language of physics. While you do not need to master math to learn physics, you do need to have conceptual clarity around calculus and have a reasonable grip on algebra, trigonometry, and geometry. So the basic idea of what really an integral does, or what really a differential element in, say, dy upon dx means, can suddenly make things a lot easier for you. And the truth is that if you just spend a few hours on understanding calculus, you can save several hours of time figuring out concepts in physics that do require some level of understanding of calculus. So make sure you cover the essentials of math well. So that brings us to number 8, which is find the best way of solving a problem. So when you've become better at a topic and are doing high level problems, start finding the best way of solving the problem. I mean, at some point of time, you'll realize that when you're attempting a problem, there might be two, or maybe sometimes even more than two, ways of solving a problem. So you should start making a conscious effort to establish what is a better way. I mean, you should not leave the problem with the first solution you've attempted. If you feel that there's something better you can do, you should go after that. And what you'll find is that in the process, things start looking easier. You'll find physics become easier because you're exploring a particular question, a particular topic in various ways. So tip number 9 is do not leave a problem after solving with any kind of doubt in mind. Well, sometimes we solve a problem and get the answer too, but somewhere in the back of our mind, we have some doubt about some part of the solution. So do not be tempted to leave the problem without clearing cobwebs of doubt. So get 100% conceptual clarity around the solution that you have found. This may require you to read the topic again, or think deeper, or maybe ask someone who knows the subject better than you. And when you do this, not only will it boost your confidence, you would have understood the topic a lot better, and this will really go a long way. So tip number 10 is revisit the chapter after you've solved a bunch of numericals. And these numericals could be easy or difficult, but once you've gone through the exercise, it could be 20 numericals, 30 numericals, or 40 numericals, depending on what test you're going to take. Is it a tough test or an easier test? Once you're done with your numerical problems, go back and read the chapter again, and you'll find your understanding of the topic would have improved several notches once you reread the chapter after you've attempted the numericals. So that brings us to the last tip, which is tip number 11. And while it is the last tip, I believe this is the most important one, and that is practice. So it sounds so obvious, but in physics, there is no tip better than this one. So let me tell you what happens when you practice enough. So you spend time on solving problems and end up getting to learn new things that you would have otherwise not thought of. In fact, even if you get the incorrect answer in the end, there's a good chance that you would have either learned something new or a new way of doing something else in the topic. Either way, you would have put more cement onto your understanding of the topic. So if you like this video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up, and please do not forget to subscribe to this channel for many more interesting videos.